equipment and stuff.
Tended to. I'd like to thank you for coming today. We're going to probably shift in the tone of the morning now. Because back in May of 2018, in fact, it was Memorial Day, we had a worship service here. Marvin was part of that. And when he went home that day, he had written down the list of songs and said, I want this to be what my funeral is like. These are not sad songs. These are not what you might think of as funeral songs, but these were his wishes. And I'll just point you quickly, as the band prepares here behind me, inside the bulletin that you received today was an excerpt from Marvin's writing, and here's what he said. My name's Jesse. I'm the pastor here who helped to plan this, but Marvin's son Gene also had a big piece of the music. Marvin said, I don't want this service to be any honor for me. I'm just a sinner saved by grace. I want this service to give glory and praise to my loving Savior Jesus. May this be the last thank you to Jesus for his great love for me. Those were the words of Marvin. Those were his wishes, and we're going to do our best to carry those out. You'll feel what you feel, and that's all right. But we invite you to worship with us. This first song is a prelude song. Sit, listen to it, let it wash over you, and then we'll continue on with our worship service. I'm so glad you're here today. Ben, let's praise God.
How I long to breathe the air of heaven, where pain is gone and mercy fills the streets, to look upon the one who bled to save me and walk with him for all eternity. There will be a day when all will bow before him. There will be a day when death will be no more, standing face to face with he who died and rose again. Holy, holy is the one voice, a thousand generations sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Forever he shall reign. Oh, there will be a day when all will bow before him. There will be a day when death will be no more, standing face to face with he who died and rose again. Holy, holy is the Lord. So let it be today, we shout the hymn of heaven with angels and the saints. We raise a mighty roar, glory to our God, his life beyond the grave. Holy, holy is the Lord. Holy, holy is
morning, everyone. Good morning, family and friends of Marvin Garris. Hebrews 9:27 reads, "Each person is destined to die." We all know that. We also know that dying is part of living. We know that at some point in our life, the death of a loved one will touch us. And that is why we have gathered here today, to remember and to celebrate the life of Marvin Garris. As I was talking to Pastor Jesse earlier this morning, I said, even in Marvin's death, he has touched me. He's gone, but you know what? He's still touching us. It's just amazing. On behalf of the Garris family, thank you for coming today. Thank you for your presence, because I know that it's a source of comfort and encouragement, and sharing in the loss lightens the load. So thank you for being here and sharing your love and support during this difficult time of loss. Please join me in prayer. Our loving Heavenly Father, if we're truthful, we admit this morning that our hearts are heavy with grief at the passing of Marvin. We miss Marvin. There's an empty chair in the back of the sanctuary where he always sits. Our sense of loss runs very deep. And so, Lord, I ask that you would give comfort and strength and peace, as only you can do. So, Father, through the tears and the pain, Lord, we have hope. We know where he is right now. We know that he is enjoying your presence. He is enjoying the splendor of heaven. And we celebrate that he is fully alive in your presence, to never again experience pain and sickness here on this earth. We remember the life that you gave Marvin and the impact that he has had on family and friends and neighbors. Lord, we ask that you would minister to each heart through this service according to the needs of our heart. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Stand with us if you'd like. I'll leave that up to you, but if you feel the need to stand, we're just going to sing a few songs here. Feel free to sing along.
And I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. Addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus.
Your name is power, your name is healing. Shadows burn like a fire.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over fear and all anxiety,
every soul held captive by depression, I speak Jesus. 'Cause your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak your holy name, Jesus. 'Cause your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. 'Cause your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire.
The name of Jesus over every heart and every mind, 'cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus.
When heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The Word became flesh and the light shined among us, his glory revealed. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day. Oh, glorious day. One day they led him up Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed him to die on a tree. Suffering anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is he. The hand that healed nations stretched out on a tree and took the nails for me. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. day the grave could conceal him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the door. Then he arose, over death he had conquered. Now is ascended, my Lord, evermore. Death could not hold him, the grave could not keep him from rising again. Living he loves me, dying he saved me. Buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified, freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. The trumpet will sound for his coming. One day the skies with his glories will shine. Wonderful day, my beloved one bringing. My Savior Jesus is mine. Living he loved me, dying he saved me. Buried he carried my sins far.
So much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings.
Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings.
The nations with truth and justice shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. And you would take my place. That you would bear. I sing for all that you've done for me.
Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquers the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquers the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down. I sing for all that you've done for me. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
You may be seated.
Hear the word of the Lord from Psalm 71. In you, Lord, I have taken refuge. Let me never be put to shame. In your righteousness, rescue me and deliver me. Turn your ear to me and save me. Be my rock of refuge, to which I can always go. Give the command to save me, for you are my rock and my fortress. Deliver me, my God, from the hand of the wicked, from the grasp of those who are evil and cruel. For you have been my hope, sovereign Lord, my confidence since my youth. From birth, I have relied on you. You brought me forth from my mother's womb. I will ever praise you. I have become a sign to many. You are my strong refuge. My mouth is filled with your praise, declaring your splendor all day long. Psalm 71, 1 to 8.
My mouth is filled with your praise, declaring your splendor all day long. That passage, Psalm 71, of course, was one that was written down and selected by Marvin some time ago. You'll notice in your bulletin, there is a time written down for memories and testimonies. Now, sometimes we call that general sharing, but you all have too many stories. There are too many of you who would love to take my place for a moment, or a long moment, or for 10 moments, and to share lots of stories. This is not just a story time. We'll do that at lunch. There is a microphone and speakers set up over in the fellowship hall for after this service. I hope you talk for a long time. What you'll notice is written down in the bulletin is memories and testimonies. What is it that you remember about Marvin? And what testimony, what does that mean? What does the memory mean? What did it point you toward? Why does it matter? That's the question. Memories and testimonies, and I'll tell you one. I got to know Marvin about 15 years ago. That was when he began attending, along with Gene and Sue, over at Media Mennonite Church, which is the same church as we are now, but about a mile south of here. So I got to know him then, and I thought, oh, this is a nice old man. 15 years ago, right? He would have at that time been in his very late 70s or early 80s. And one of the things that I remember, we had painted the inside of our sanctuary about the same color that this one is, and we had professional painters come in to do most of the walls and the ceilings and the really high stuff, but there was a lot of trim that needed to be painted. There were 8 windows with old wood trim and all the trim around the stage, and Marvin said, well, I can do that. And so he did. While I worked in my office for several days over several weeks, He was there painting. He went and selected the paint, bought it, had it stacked up at the right spot, everything labeled perfectly. And this old man spent a lot of time on his knees, on stools, doing the fine work around the window, carrying a bucket of paint and a paintbrush. I was impressed by that, and I enjoyed getting to know him a little bit better through those times when he and I were the only ones in the building often. And I said to him, "Marvin, thank you so much for doing this." And this was his response, and he said this over and over through the years. He said, "Well, I really used to work hard with my body, and I can't work that hard anymore, but I can do this, and so I do this." That was beautiful to me. And I've heard that refrain several times over the last 15 years as his body continued to weaken and as there were more things that he used to do that he could no longer do, but he was still engaged up until a few weeks ago, still writing letters and encouragements to people from our congregation. So that's my memory. And I'll just tell you that his life was a testimony to me of how God can use anyone in any stage of life to serve the kingdom. What memories do you have? What would you like to share? And you know, even if it is just a story, we might allow it. Do you have anything that you'd like to share with the family or that you'd like to share with the gathered congregation at this time? If you do, come forward and I will share with you.
In 2019, my wife's sister passed away from breast cancer. It was in the fall of 19, and we were here. I started in March of 19, so this was in the fall of 19, so just a few months. And my wife's sister passed away from breast cancer in Atlanta. And when we got home from the funeral, there was a card from Marvin. And he wrote my wife a beautiful card of encouragement and scripture. And not only did she get a note, but there was also a note for my wife's brother-in-law. I was like, "Marvin, you don't even know this guy." But yet he was touched enough to write him a note as well. And that just really stuck with me. It's like, wow. And I know many of you here have received his notes too. And like Pastor Jesse said, yeah, he couldn't do a whole lot, but he could still write. And I know he apologized to me for his sloppy handwriting. But it's like, Marvin, it's the words that you wrote that meant so much, mm-hmm. not the style of your handwriting. Mm-hmm.
Just to piggyback on that, Marvin wrote my son-in-law a note when he was going to go through a...
Okay.
Didn't know they were that sensitive. Marvin wrote my son-in-law a note also when he was going to go through a pretty serious surgery and questioning whether this was going to be life-changing for him or not. Marvin never met him, but it meant a lot to Steve and it meant a lot to me. The other thing I wanted to mention was that I grew up Brethren, so foot washing was normal way of life for me since little on up. Marvin took it to another level. We would wash each other's feet, and every time he'd wash my feet, he'd say, "It's an honor for me to wash your feet."
I'm Gil Bishop. Older folks know me as Gilly. We've known the Garrises our whole lives. The Bishop Farm, Garris Farm, they were nearby. And that generation, they were all best friends. And I learned to know Marvin when he was working at Bob's Texaco station. And it wasn't just a gas station. He had boxes of live animals outside coons and squirrels and anything for people to come see his little zoo. He just loved the animals. And through the years, like I said, our families are best friends. Dad got Marvin a job at Weaver Steel where Dad worked. Dad was invited to go with the Garrises up to Maine hunting, which was done since the 50s. And then I started hunting at Marvin's house after the Garrises bought their 10 acres up the street from there, and Marvin had the chance to buy his house, so I would hunt there. And I was blessed later, as Marvin and Louise moved into the trailer, we bought Marvin's house with three other families, which was the greatest experience in the world for 12 years. And Marvin was, excuse me, Marvin was just such a great example to our kids. Him and Louise were just like grandparents. And the kids would just couldn't wait till the evening when the sun went down. We could go over to Marvin's for peach tea. He always had peach tea. And they loved picking his blueberries, his garden, which was a phenomenal. And Marvin and Louise just cared about everybody. And But I loved the way Marvin took care of Louise. He made sure she'd stay in the house. He put a chair lift in, and eventually they moved in the trailer and we bought the house. But they freely gave that chair lift to friends from our church, Roland and Peg Detweiler, so she could have one. And Marvin, again, would send us cards and letters. And last year when I talked to him, he said, well, I don't do as many Christmas cards, it's too many, but I send letters throughout the year to people that need encouragement. And you know, the one year where he sent his writing on what Christmas is all about, it was so great. I took it to our Sunday school class at Blooming Glen Mennonite, read that to them. And the man, he was Christ. Mm. And before I cry, I'll say, I appreciate him so much. Mm-hmm.
I'm Chris Garris. I was Marvin's niece, and I was blessed. We've heard about his card ministry, and I remember a number of years ago getting a card from him, and he wrote, you know, and he said, I pray for you every day. And now I serve as a missionary in Thailand. And then the next time I saw him, I said, you know, I just want to thank you. And he did one of these. He said, I pray for you every day. And I took that as the truth, and that to me was, the card writing was a blessing and an encouragement, and his ministry of intercession, we will only one day know what that has done. And that was such a blessing to me. A couple years ago, I got to go to the home, to his home, to share my PowerPoint with him, and he, you could tell he reads my prayer letters, because he was interrogating, asking questions, wanting to know more, so he could pray more specifically. And you know, as he passed, I thought, you know, I just lost a significant intercessor. And as I was here today, meeting some of his grandchildren who I've never met before, two of them asked if they could sign up and get on my prayer partner list, my newsletters. And I thought, now that's his legacy. And that would really honor him. And that is just what will be an impact for eternity.
Amen.
Okay, I'm used to like the singing mic, not this kind of mic. So my husband and I first moved here about like 6-ish, 7 years ago. So this is Jonathan's hometown, it's not mine. So I don't know, or I didn't know a lot of people when we first moved here. But Marvin just was such an encouragement to me. Coming to this congregation, he just like made me feel so welcome, and he would sit in the back and just with beaming smile when I was singing up on the platform. And then when I would come down, he would, you know, pull me aside or tap my shoulder and say, that was really good, you know, or that was beautiful. And he was just such an encouragement to me. And that encouraged me when I was going through a hard time and just finding my place here. And so, yeah, I think encouragement is a huge part of Marvin's legacy.
Amen.
Jesse's right. There are a lot of stories that would take a long time. And Marvin was part of our Bible study, so we heard them, and they were wonderful. But the story is that when my husband was ill, he was well enough one time to go on an MDS trip with Marvin. And so they went down, I think it was a Florida trip. So they get down there, and Jim couldn't do much physically. So Marvin put him as a supervisor. And Marvin did all the work, whatever he could do. And they became buddies. When I talked to Marvin the last time, he said, "I'll look Jim up for you." He was a good man.
How many of you ever heard Marvin say, just as Chris heard and just as I heard, "I'm praying for you every day"? How many of you heard that? Raise a hand. Hey, family, look around. See how many hands are up. How many of you, church, you who are here, I know some of you attended church here with Marvin. Some of you had history with Marvin as a family or as a friend at another fellowship. Some of you were simply neighbors and you're here out of respect. But how many of you ever received a handwritten card or note from Marvin Garris? Would you stand up? Stand up if you ever received a handwritten card or note from Marvin Garris. Family, look around. We're not celebrating Marvin today, but we're celebrating what God has done through him. You may be seated. Marvin was a humble man and didn't want a big to-do made about himself. He was a man of faith, and he pointed to Jesus, or attempted to point to Jesus in everything that he did. But we will not forget today Marvin's faithfulness to the ways that God called him. I've saved some of the letters that he wrote to me. And just a few weeks ago, I was catching up, telling him about some things that were happening in my family and in my life and with my daughter. And he said, "You know, I pray for her every day." And it touched my heart. And I can't tell you how many times in the last couple of days I too thought, "I wonder if my life is going to be any different, having lost that one person who I know was faithful in praying for me and praying for my daughter." His prayers will be missed, but congregation, he's not the only one who can pray. You and I can too. Today can be a powerful reminder for us that though we've lost a friend, a grandfather, a father, an uncle, though we've lost a prayer intercessor, someone who was thinking of us and praying for us, even if we didn't realize it, even though we will miss him, do you realize the power of God that is available if we will simply turn to the Lord and engage with our God in the way that Marvin so humbly, carefully, and faithfully did? You know, those kind of prayers that he prayed are not something that was only an ability for him. That kind of connection with the Lord is available for us as well. And that's the kind of thing that I continued to hear Marvin saying over and over and over in his whole life that I knew him, but especially in these last 2 to 3 months where he really was not able to get up and around, where he really began to feel that the end was truly near. This is why I suspect this is why he chose Psalm 71 to read. Pastor Steve read it for us a bit earlier, at least the first 8 verses. I'm going to read it for you again, and here's what I'd like to invite you to listen for. The person who wrote the psalm says a lot of things about God's faithfulness. But the person who wrote the psalm also made a number of declarations about what they would do in response to God's faithfulness. And so listen, I'm going to read you the whole psalm. Hang in there. You look like a sharp crowd. I think you can stay engaged through these 24 verses. But this is Psalm 71. Listen again to God's faithfulness and our opportunity to respond. See what this says to us. In you, Lord, I have taken refuge. Let me never be put to shame. In your righteousness, rescue me and deliver me. Turn your ear to me and save me. Be my rock of refuge to which I can always go. Give the command and save me, for you are my rock and my fortress. Deliver me, my God, from the hand of the wicked, from the grasp of those who are evil and cruel. For you have been my hope, sovereign Lord, my confidence since my youth. From birth I have relied on you. You brought me forth from my mother's womb. I will ever praise you. I have become a sign to many. You are my strong refuge. My mouth is filled with your praise, declaring your splendor all day long. And now verse 9. You didn't hear this yet today, but listen again for the faithfulness of God and the opportunity to respond by humanity. Psalm 71, verse 9. Do not cast me away when I'm old. Do not forsake me when my strength is gone. For my enemies speak against me. Those who wait to kill me conspire together. They say, God has forsaken him. Pursue him and seize him, for no one will rescue him. Do not be far from me, my God. Come quickly, God, to help me. May my accusers perish in shame. May those who want to harm me be covered with scorn and disgrace. As for me, I will always have hope. I will praise you more and more. My mouth will tell of your righteous deeds, of your saving acts all day long, though I know not how to relate them all. I will come and proclaim your mighty acts, sovereign Lord. I will proclaim your righteous deeds, yours alone. Since my youth, God, you have taught me, and to this day I declare your marvelous deeds. Even when I'm old and gray, do not forsake me, God, till I declare your power to the next generation, your mighty acts to all who are to come. Your righteousness, God, reaches to the heavens. You have done great things. Who is like you, God? Though you have made me see troubles, many and bitter, you will restore my life again. From the depths of the earth, you will again bring me up. You will increase my honor and comfort me once more. I will praise you with the harp for your faithfulness, my God. I will sing praise to you with the lyre, Holy One of Israel. My lips will shout for joy when I sing praise to you, I whom you have delivered. My tongue will tell of your righteous acts all day long. For those who wanted to harm me have been put to shame and confusion. Church, there are a lot of things that we cannot control. Even as our world seems to grow and grow and grow, even as technology adds to our abilities for many of us, even as most of us don't have to fear hunger the way generations may have before, the way other places of the world may fear it, even though many of us are comfortable in our homes and we can go to the wall and decide if it's too hot or too cold, push a few buttons and be relieved of our discomfort soon. Even in the midst of this world where we can push a lot of buttons and even with our physical bodies make a lot of things happen, there are things we cannot control, right? We cannot control it when, as the psalmist says, our enemies conspire against us. No matter how loving or kind or gracious we may be, there are always those who strive to take advantage of us. We see this in our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Even though his actions were perfect, his love and his words and his deeds were clearly from the Lord, there were those who hated him, a man of sorrows. There are things that we cannot control. There are things that happen to us. How many times in this psalm did the psalmist say, when I am old and gray? Right? We age, some of us more gracefully than others, but we all age. There was one of the pictures in the slideshow this morning where I saw one of you down in kind of a catcher's stance, sitting on your knees beside Marvin. I thought, I wonder if that guy can still sit that way. Not only can he get up after he sits. Our bodies age, don't they? Now, there are a few of you in the room who are still yet to see your physical prime. You're still growing. You're still putting on weight, good weight. But many of us in the room, how many of us can look back and say, I can't do all the things I once did? There are things that we cannot control. If we don't die, we will age. This is part of our reality. Marvin knew it, saw it, faced it. Now he's done with it. There are things that we can't control, but church, there are so many things that are within our power to determine. We can determine the words that we say, can't we? Most of us who are healthy, most of us whose minds are healthy, we are able to control our words. What did this psalmist say over and over and over? Lord, you have been my hope. You have been my confidence. I have relied on you. And in Psalm 71:6, he said, I will ever praise you. We can control whether we praise God or not, right? We have control over our words. In Psalm 71:14, the psalmist says, as for me, I will always have hope. I will praise you more and more. Verse 15, my mouth will tell of your righteous deeds, of your saving acts all day long. How many of you have control over your mouth? How many of you have control over your words? The psalmist reminds us, use your mouth, make choices with your words to give praise to God. I heard that encouragement from Marvin as well, as did you. There are things that happen to us and around us that are out of our control. They drive us crazy. We don't like it. Sometimes we would even say there are evil things happening around us. Those things we must trust to God. Those things that are out of our control, we must have hope for. But let us not forget that even in the midst of those challenges and struggles, in the illness and in the aging, we still have control over our mouths. We have an opportunity to have control over our actions as well, don't we? Now, some of us, our bodies don't respond the way we think they will. I didn't get out of the way as quickly as I might have 10 years ago. Right? There are ways that our bodies betray us. But for the most part, we can control what we do. I was so impressed. A number of years ago, Marvin gave a presentation at Media Mennonite Church about the Seagoing Cowboys. Some of you saw a book on the back table related to that. You've seen pictures, perhaps. When Marvin was a very young man, he decided to give his time to help replenish the stables of war-torn Europe by getting cattle across the ocean with other young men. The sacrifices, the work that it would have taken. Some of you know what it's like to care for livestock here in the buildings that you've carefully built for them. Imagine a ship across the ocean for weeks. I've tried not to imagine what that work would have been like. But here's a man in Marvin who chose and said, yeah, I'll go do that. Maybe there could have been work that he could have done otherwise. Maybe there was a different way that he could have spent his time. But he said, my response is under my control, and so I will serve. How many of you have control over your bodies? Even larger, control over your time. You don't know how much time you have, but you didn't have to come today. You could have stayed home, but you're here. You chose to be here. What are you going to choose to do with this afternoon? What are you doing this evening and tomorrow? What are you doing for the rest of your lives? You and I have obligations. We have responsibilities. People that love us and they count on us. But our actions and our words are under our control. How are you going to use these things? The choices that we make with our words, with our actions, with our time, they go a long way to defining our lives. I said to a couple of you here this morning, this may sound weird, family, I've been enjoying this morning. It's hard to see you go through pain, but as I see the pictures of Marvin, and as I remember a life well lived, and as I think about the hope that I have about his reality right now, knowing that there's no more pain, that this old body is just a husk, I'm filled with hope and joy even in the midst of all kinds of emotions. But I said to a couple of you this morning, I hope that when I die, people think about me the way I think about Marvin. And you know, the words and the actions that I carry out for the rest of my life are going to have a lot to do with the way people remember me. The psalmist reminds us there are things outside of our control, but with all of the things that are in our control, will you point your words, your actions, and your time to the Lord? Or is it all about you? I'm going to close with this. In August, I was sitting in Marvin's trailer. He was reclined back in his chair. We were telling some stories. I had read some Bible verses. I could see at that moment he was not feeling very well, but he was excited for the visit. I was there in the middle of the day on a weekday, as sometimes only us pastors are available to do. We were telling stories. And he told me about how, Dennis Lynn, you sent him an African violet in 2000 when Marvin, the way he said it to me, when my wife died. I had never heard this story. I leaned in. He said that his wife, your mother, loved violets. Marvin reported that it was lavender. But when the package arrived from UPS, the flower had been carefully, but when it arrived, the violet needed to be repotted. So Marvin told me that he snapped off all the flowers to give it a fresh start, and that when it bloomed back, instead of being lavender again, it was white. He had had pictures before and pictures after, and I think you and I both know that Marvin was precise enough not to mix up his potted plants. So the lavender flower rebloomed in white. He had a botanist friend, and he asked him about this, and the botanist said, that kind of flower doesn't rebloom in different colors. The botanist said to him, that's a miracle. Marvin looked at me and said, I believe that was a miracle. And then he added this. He said, I think it symbolized my wife's new white clothes in heaven, where she is with the Lord today. There were a lot of things that were outside of Marvin's control. There were a lot of things that were not as he would have had them to be if it would have been up to him. But the things that he could control, his attitude, his words, and his time, he pointed them and focused them on the Lord. That flower symbolizes my wife's new white clothes in heaven. May we be as faithful with the things that we can control so that the Lord gets glory and so that one day we may hear, well done, good and faithful servant. Would you pray with me? Thank you, Lord, for the chance to be together today. Lord, many of us wish that we could see Marvin in his strength one more time. But God, help us to find hope in the belief that he is indeed with you. Because he declared his faith in you. And because he declared Jesus Christ as his Savior, and because he believed in you, Lord, we believe that he is in your hands now. Lord, help us as we are together, as we choose to praise you. Help us, God, to have the kind of sweet spirit about us that allows us to live our days well, however many days we may have. We pray in the powerful name of Jesus Christ. Amen. We've got two closing songs today. One is a short medley of How Great Is Our God and How Great Thou Art. The final and closing song is Lion of Judah. It's one that we've played a lot here at church. It seems to keep coming back in some of these services. Folks, when they plan for funerals, for their funerals here at Waterway, for whatever reason, this is one that keeps coming back, although I'll suggest to you that it's another one of those that doesn't sound like a funeral song. If you're able to stand, would you stand with us? It's okay to remain seated if you need to. We're going to close by singing How Great Is Our God and Lion of Judah.
Splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God. Name above all names, worthy of all praise. My heart will sing, how great is our God. Name above all names, worthy of all praise. My heart will sing, how great is our God. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God. Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art. Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God.
You're the the Lion of Judah, the Lamb who was slain. You ascended to heaven and evermore will reign. At the end of the age, when the earth you reclaim, you will gather the nations before you. And the eyes of all men will be fixed on the Lamb who was crucified. With wisdom and mercy and justice you'll reign at your Father's side. And the angels will cry, Hail the Lamb, who was slain for the world. And the earth will reply, You shall reign as the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords. There's a shield in our hand and a sword at our side. There's fire in our spirits that cannot be denied. Cause the Father has told us, for these you have died. For the nations that gather before you. And the ears of all men need to hear of the Lamb who was crucified. Who descended to hell yet was raised up to reign at his Father's side. And the angels will cry, Hail the Lamb, who is slain for the world, rule in power. And the earth will reply, You shall reign as the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords. And the angels will cry, Hail. Slain for the world, rule in power. And the earth will reply, You shall reign as the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords.
Congregation, you may be seated. There is coming a time where the Lord Jesus Christ will return. Whether people recognize him now or not, he will return. And on him will be written the King of Kings and Lord of all lords. And there will be a time where justice will be measured out by our perfect Lord, not from human perspectives and not based on human arrogance, but based on the truth of God's perfect judgment. A time is coming where the whole world will bow their heads and bend their knees and recognize that he is the Lord. Will you recognize it, though, before you're made to? Will you put your faith in Jesus Christ before he comes back and it is so obvious, but the time is too late? You get to choose whether you believe in him or not. And we can talk theological details all day about how that happens or why, but I am suggesting to you right now that all of you get to choose now whether you will follow Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior or not. I invite you to make the choice that Marvin made, the choice that we have made, and the choice that we proclaim every time we gather together here at Waterway Church. Will you choose life? Will you serve the Lord Jesus Christ? He is the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords. Amen? If you have any questions about what all that means, I'd love to talk to you further. And I know there are members of the family in this congregation who can explain those things to you in greater detail if you'd like. Don't hesitate. Because we have a lunch prepared right across the hallway in the fellowship hall. You are all invited. Tell your stories. Tell them around the table with each other. And any time during the day, there is a microphone and some speakers up front. That is for you if you have something that you need to share with the whole group that you didn't get to share so far. There is no rush. There's no end time, although we do have Sunday school at 9:30 tomorrow. hang out and enjoy each other and enjoy the food and the fellowship for as long as you'd like. Okay? Right now, what we're going to do is I'm going to say a quick prayer for that meal. After I pray, the funeral directors are going to come forward and they're going to take care of a few details here in the front. The family will leave the room and go out into the lobby and do just a few things while the rest of you wait here for a moment. And after the family has had their final prayer together, I'll come back in and dismiss you, and you can go. You can eat lunch, you can visit with any family that's hanging around, or you can go on about serving the Lord the rest of your day. Can we pray for the food? Lord, you bless us with the opportunity to eat. Thank you. As we eat, Lord, please nourish our bodies physically so that we might have strength. But Lord, nourish our spirits and our hearts and our minds so that we might have wisdom and that we might have courage to sing your praises all day long. Thank you, Lord. Thank you that we get to celebrate Jesus and the life of Marvin Garris today. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Again, family, keep your seats. We're going to recess. I'll be back in to dismiss all of you at the appropriate time.